Nice to meet you.
I hope you're not transgenic. I hope you are the original one.
What? No, I'm original.
Stay original.
Quisiera preguntarte rápidamente qué acciones aconsejas que podamos tomar contra las corporaciones internacionales que buscan apoderarse de los alimentos nativos.
I think the first thing you can do is save the seeds, your own seeds.
Lo primero que puedes hacer es salvar tus semillas, tus propias semillas.
Second is to spread the gardens and make the gardens sanctuaries for you, so that you flourish.
Lo segundo es hacer más jardines y hacer de los jardines santuarios para ti, para que puedas seguir creciendo.
And third, make sure everyone wants to eat you rather than that poison.
Y lo tercero es asegurarse que todo el mundo te quiera comer a ti en vez de ese veneno espantoso.
That means you have to link the farmer that grows the seed to the eater. And farmers markets, direct relationships, we will have to create them, because otherwise it will be a world of Monsanto. And a world of Monsanto will be bad for you and will be bad for us.
Y lo que tienes que asegurarte es llegar a toda la gente, a través de mercados, de productores, a través de lugares donde se venda y se conozca todos tus beneficios y que realmente todo el mundo tenga acceso. Porque si no hacemos eso, este será un mundo de Monsanto y no un mundo del maíz criollo.
nosotros tener este público y tener hoy aquí a Vandana Shiva, que ha hecho un esfuerzo gigantesco para poder viajar desde la India hasta México y estar aquí esta tarde con nosotros en la sexta edición de Cinema Planeta, Festival Internacional Medio Ambiente de México. Hoy Cinema Planeta está llegando a su final de su sexta edición. Hemos tenido todo un mes de actividades, iniciando en el día de la primavera con la proyección de polen, y posteriormente empezamos con nuestras actividades educativas, con las escuelas, en donde llevamos a 30.000 estudiantes a las salas de cine. Posteriormente inauguramos también 3 exposiciones. Seguimos con la inauguración del Festival Cinematográfico. Después empezó esta semana de cine. En donde proyectamos más de 100 títulos de 26 países de los 5 continentes. Y estamos llegando hoy muy contentos al cierre de nuestras actividades, hoy domingo 13. Y lo vamos a hacer con una conferencia magistral. A mí me queda decirles que este trabajo que hacemos en Cinema Planeta lo hacemos de todo corazón. Para ustedes, para Morelos, y para México y para el mundo. Sentimos que el cine, el arte, la ciencia es el vehículo por medio del cual realmente podemos hacer una transformación de nuestras sociedades. Ahora quiero llamar aquí al escenario a Plutarco Emilio García Jiménez, quien es dirigente nacional de la Coordinadora Plan de Ayala, director de la Universidad Campesina del Sur y miembro de la campaña Sin Maíz No Hay País. Un aplauso para él, por favor.
Compañeras y compañeros, amigas y amigas, todos que acuden a esta histórica cita. Me han concedido el alto honor de que, a nombre de los organizadores y de nuestro estado, dé las palabras de bienvenida a la doctora Vandana Shiva. Doctora, sea usted bienvenida al estado de Morelos, cuna del agrarismo mexicano y tierra natal del general revolucionario Emiliano Zapata. Bienvenida a la tierra de Quetzalcóatl, el dios que entregó a los hombres el maíz para alimentarse. Es un honor tenerla entre nosotros, y desde este rincón de México, sepa usted que compartimos su lucha por la defensa de las semillas nativas, por la defensa de la soberanía alimentaria, la biodiversidad, los derechos de la madre tierra, el ecofeminismo, la democracia de la tierra, la paz y otro mundo posible. La hemos visto recorrer el mundo apoyando a los movimientos sociales. Su presencia en México alienta la lucha social y ambiental de muchas organizaciones campesinas e indígenas y de la sociedad civil, como es el caso del trabajo de Cinema Planeta, como la campaña Sin Maíz No Hay País, la Coordinadora Nacional Plan de Ayala, Semillas de Vida y todas las presentes que luchan contra el neoliberalismo y el capitalismo salvaje. Ha sido usted impulsora de movimientos y redes internacionales como la Vía Campesina, el Foro Social Mundial, lo que fue la Red Interamericana de Agriculturas y Democracia. Alguna vez nos encontramos en Porto Alegre, Brasil. La Coordinadora Latinoamericana de Organizaciones del Campo y muchas, muchísimas otras organizaciones. Por ello, doctora Vandana Shiva, la recibimos y la reconocemos como heroína ambiental y de los movimientos sociales. Aquí en Cuernavaca, ciudad de la eterna primavera, la recibimos con los brazos abiertos. Muchas gracias.
La doctora Vandana Shiva es una de las activistas más reconocidas internacionalmente por su lucha contra los cultivos transgénicos y en defensa de las semillas criollas, así como en la denuncia de los daños de la globalización al servicio de las grandes compañías y en particular de las dedicadas a la alimentación. Es doctora en física y fundadora en India de la asociación Gardania, dedicada a proteger la diversidad e integridad de los recursos vivos, especialmente de semillas nativas, la promoción de la agricultura orgánica y el comercio justo. Durante las últimas dos décadas, Gardania ha trabajado con las comunidades y organizaciones locales al lado de más de 500.000 hombres y mujeres dedicados al trabajo agrícola. Los esfuerzos de Gardania han dado lugar a la conservación de más de 3.000 variedades de arroz de todo el país y han establecido 60 bancos de semillas en 16 estados del país. Shiva ha contribuido de manera fundamental en la evolución de la práctica de los paradigmas de la agricultura y la alimentación. Sus libros, La violencia de la revolución verde y El monocultivo de la mente, retan el paradigma dominante de la agricultura no sostenible y reduccionista de la revolución verde. A través de sus libros, Biopiratería, El saqueo de la naturaleza y del conocimiento, Cosecha robada, El secuestro del suministro mundial de alimentación y Las guerras del agua, privatización, contaminación y lucro, la doctora Shiva ha hecho visibles los costos sociales, económicos y ecológicos de la globalización dirigida por las empresas. Entre los muchos premios que ha recibido está el Premio Nobel Alternativo en 1993, la Orden del Arca Dorada, Premio Global 500 de la Organización de las Naciones Unidas y el Premio del Día Internacional de la Tierra. En 2009 obtuvo el Premio Lennon Ono por la Paz, en 2010 el Premio de la Paz de Sydney, Toshi y el Premio Calgary por la Paz y el Premio Thomas Merton en año 2011. Bienvenida, Vandana.
Thank you very much, Gustavo. Thank you, Eleonora. Thank you for the work you put in to make this film festival for the planet possible. And thank you all for coming to this beautiful evening in this most amazing space. Now, this could have been a dump yard, as so many of the rivers of the world have become. They've become drains to carry the waste of industry and city. And the wisdom of the leaders who decided that this would stay for the common good is a lesson that it's very easy to create privatization. It's very easy to declare the earth and her gifts as property and commodity. But it takes a lot of love and a lot of hard work and a lot of intelligence and a lot of wisdom to know that clean rivers must flow and clean seeds must give us food. This corn is not a thing, not a mine for genes. It is, as was mentioned in the welcoming remarks and as I have learned over my many visits to Mexico, that this is the earth herself.
It's divinity. It's the ancestors. It's all the relationships between all the people and all the species that contributed to this colony. They can't be erased. You know, I did my PhD thesis on the foundations of quantum theory. And the two aspects of quantum theory that are really lessons that we all should learn. The first is the recognition of non-separation, non-separability. That nothing can be separated because in the web of life, everything is connected. That's how life is created. In a community, every person is connected. And we are connected to the past. We're connected to the future. Now, the recent thinking of what is called scientific, on the basis of which genetic engineering is based, on the basis of which chemical industrial farming is based, imagines the world as just dead things. This is just dead matter. And it's only when a company or a scientist pulls out a gene from this corn and puts it into another corn, or pulls out a gene from a soil organism, the Bt, the Bacillus thuringiensis, puts it into the corn using a gene gun. That's how they do it. They don't do delicate breeding. They shoot in the dark. They just use a gene gun. And then they don't know if it's getting absorbed, so they add antibiotic resistance markers. Because there's intelligence in the cells say, I don't want this toxic. Take it away. So they have to put viruses to promote. Every GMO is a lethal mixture of new genes that don't belong to that plant. And because they think they're just moving things around, there's no consequence, but there are huge consequences. I was once in a debate with the genetic engineering industry, and a Monsanto representative said, by the time we are finished, there will be zero value in the corn that the peasants have cultivated. And the only value will be the genes we put into it, which are our property. It's not an accident that agriculture is becoming unviable, because it has been designed to destroy farming. It has been designed to destroy sovereignty and freedom. It's been designed to take over agriculture by a handful of companies. But the consequences of that concentration and the consequence of that false claim to ownership, false claim to creation, are huge. When I heard these companies talk in 1987 about how they were going to do genetic engineering in order to take a patent, this is so delicious. No one should drink Coca-Cola. This is much, much, much. So they said we have to do genetic engineering because then we can claim we have invented the seed. And then we can take a patent, which means an invention. Then we can take royalties, which is like taxes. And that's how we're going to grow. So who were the companies? They're the same companies that brought us the poisons in farming, the pesticides and the herbicides, fertilizers. And where did these come from? Well, humanity has farmed for 10,000 years. Mexico has grown corn for thousands of years. We've grown rice and wheat and all our other crops. Never needed the pesticides, never needed the fertilizers. The tragedy is that during the war, corporations started to make chemicals for killing, explosives for killing. After the war, they made the factories that were making explosives now make synthetic nitrogen fertilizer. But the methods were the same. And that's why nitrogen fertilizer makes very good nitrogen bombs that are used all the time. Pesticides were first designed for killing people in concentration camps and then used for the wars. But when the wars were over, they said, we won't give up our habit of making money out of killing. We will convert agriculture into a war-based system. But of course, if they came to you and said, we're going to now declare war on your maize, would you have accepted those poisons? No. They had to tell you, you will have more food. You will have food security. This is the answer to feeding the hungry. They also twisted the arms of various governments. That's how Mexico got the Green Revolution, and we got the Green Revolution. Herbicides were made for warfare, like Agent Orange. Never designed for agriculture, because in our systems, we love things to grow together. Navdanya, the movement I started, means 9 crops growing together. Milpa, the amazing farming system of Mexico, means you have your full kitchen growing in your farm. You've got the corn in all its diversity, you've got the beans, again in all their diversity, and then you've got the squash. And today when I walk through the market, it was so beautiful. There were women selling the corn and the beans and the squash and the pumpkin seeds. You eat all of that, it's totally balanced. And then all the greens that we've been given. I was so happy the women launched incredible edibles. There they are. And part of the reason we have so much destruction of agriculture is those who only knew how to kill. When they came into agriculture, they had no idea of how much biodiversity there is. They have no idea how many corn varieties you grow. They had no idea when they started to introduce the new rices in India that we had 200,000 kinds of rice evolved. Rices, some rices for babies, some for old people, some rices that can grow with salt water, some rices that can grow with no water. 70% of the rices that we've saved can go without irrigation. But the Green Revolution rices require a spread of irrigation. And like you have the corn and the beans, and the US, they call them the Three Sisters in the First Nations, our rice never grew alone. We grew shrimp with it. There'd be ducks with it. In our wheat fields, we would have chickpea, or we would have mustard. Our plants were never lonely. They always had company. And that company meant there was more cooperation. The beans gave nitrogen to the corn. You don't need chemical fertilizers. And the cover crops, when your field is covered with the squash, the weeds don't come. Because that cover is preventing the emergence of weeds. And when you have different crops, different insects feed on different crops, and then they create balance among themselves to not allow any one insect to become a pest. But in agriculture, a war is an agriculture. Create the chemical that kills. That's the only knowledge. There is no knowledge of life. There's no knowledge of the soil. They literally call, in chemical farming, they call the soil the empty container. It's an empty container. And of course, they bombard with the herbicides and the pesticides. Then you get new diseases. Then they get more fungicides. They get new generations of pesticides. And finally, the same companies that brought the poisons saying, we will solve the problem of hunger by genetically engineering the corn and genetically engineering the cotton and the soya bean to give you more yields, to get rid of the use of chemicals in agriculture, and to give you a smart agriculture for the future. I call it the stupid agriculture. It's stupid and unintelligent because it does not base itself on the intelligence of nature, the intelligence of the earth, the intelligence in the corn. There is intelligence in this corn. And that intelligence is what it has allowed to travel over thousands of years and holds the potential for thousands of years more. And in our seed saving, we've realized that this word called primitive varieties, they call our seeds primitive varieties. Our seeds are intelligence of nature and our ancestors. These are intelligences. And why do I call industrial agriculture, transgenics, stupid? I call it stupid because it is stupid to kill life. It's not intelligent. I call it stupid because there is no understanding of what is food. That food must be nutritious, food must be tasty, food must come from the land, food must come from the knowledge of our grandmothers. Then it's real food. The kind of meal I had this afternoon was real food. Very often, they pretend to make Mexican food in the US, and sometimes they take me. I've never to date finished a tamale in the United States. And it's so tasteless. And I totally finished my plate this afternoon. So food must have nutrition. Food must have taste, food must nourish the earth, must nourish the farmer, and it must nourish our bodies. But when they talk about the smart technologies, have you got more food through genetic engineering? No. When you shoot with a gene gun, a toxic gene, you're not increasing that plant's ability to yield. The plant gives its own yield. If they put a BT gene into this corn would be the corn with the yield of this corn. It doesn't come from the trans gene, so they don't produce more. That's the first lie. They don't reduce chemicals. Because the BT crops, the corn they want to do is a BT corn. It actually is creating super pests. In India, they introduced a BT cotton. Monsanto did it illegally. I had to take them to court. Eventually, they got the approvals. In a decade, they took control of our entire cotton seed sector. 95% of the cotton seed in India is owned by Monsanto. For every seed planted by the farmer, half of the price of seed goes to St. Louis in Missouri, to the headquarters of Monsanto. Half the price. How much has the price jumped? 8,000%. 8,000%. The seed which belonged to the farmer. Today they are paying 8,000% more than the local seeds they would have bought from exchange. It doesn't work to control the pests. It has created new pests. Pests we've never had. It's a pest-producing crop. And the pest they wanted to control, the bollworm, has become resistant. So the farmers are using 13 times more pesticide. The 13-fold more pesticide, the 8,000% more price of seed. And the failure, we had a wonderful peasant woman this morning who said her seed has never failed. How can the seeds of the earth and the seeds of our ancestors fail us? They've been tested over 10,000 years. Transgenics are untested. And the same transgenic is sold across countries. I remember last year when I came, they wanted to plant on 6,000 acres. No, 6 million acres at one go.
Were they going to breed a different corn for this field and another corn for that field and a different unique variety? No, they were going to bring one variety, poison it with BT, and sell it to every farmer. So there's more frequent failure. The combination of high costs, more pesticides, more frequent failure has trapped our cotton farmers into an unpayable debt. And more than 284,000 Indian farmers have committed suicide since Monsanto came into India. We have prevented them from spreading into any other crop. We prevented them from introducing a GMO eggplant. They sneaked it to the neighboring Bangladesh, and in Bangladesh it's failing. Little plants like that are all shriveled up, diseased, dying. They're telling the farmers, spray pesticide. It was brought as a miracle that would never need pesticide. I do not want to see Mexican farmers facing the plight that our cotton farmers face. Mexico has spread corn across the world with generosity. So much of the staple in all Africa's staple has become corn now. It wasn't earlier, but now it's corn. In some parts of the Himalaya, it's corn. Now, most of the transgenic corn is actually not food. It's not food because it's not worthy of being eaten. That's why the poor Americans keep saying, allow us to have labeling so we can know what food is transgenic. And the companies pour 40 million per state. California, Washington, they pour $40 million for false advertising. The poor Americans don't know what they're eating. They don't have a right to know. That is killing the democracy of food. Because if you don't know what you're eating and food is what you become, then you don't know who you are. Joke and say this arrogance of claiming seeds you have basically stolen, putting poison into them and saying I'm the creator, is GMO means God womb over. And since our gods are in our seeds, our gods are in our corn and in our rice, we worship our rice as Lakshmi, the goddess of wealth. This is real wealth. Our gods are not going to move over. They'll move the false gods out. But there's another reason why the transgenics are stupid. So having sprayed herbicides and killed all the greens we ate. For example, imagine a field of corn which is herbicide resistant. Will that be able to grow your beans and your squash? No. Because the herbicide resistant crop means you will spray the herbicide and kill everything else. You will kill the green. Now it's those greens that have been the sources of vitamin A. They have been the sources of iron. As those sprays of herbicides have destroyed our food sources and our sources of nutrition, of course there's increasing deficiency. Of course there's iron deficiency anemia in the world. And of course our children are not getting enough vitamin A. The intelligent solution is grow diversity again. Bring the milpa back. Create the fields of Navdanya, the nine seeds, the nine crops. The stupid attitude is, oh, we killed everything for a green revolution rice or a green revolution maize, and now what we'll do is put into the rice, which is nutritionally empty, we will put a yellow color. And they call it golden rice. And they said this will produce vitamin A. Initially, this is going to solve blindness across the world and save children from going blind. The content was so low that anyone would have needed to eat 3 kilograms of rice per day to get their daily requirement of vitamin A. Then they increased it a little bit, and now it has reached 35 micrograms in 1 gram of food. So if you don't, if it's zero in rice and you go to 35, you think you have made a big leap. You have reached the moon. When you compare it to other things, I noticed you had a lot of amaranth. Amaranth leaves give you 141 micrograms compared to the 35. We use a lot of coriander. I don't know if you use coriander too. It's 69. We use a lot of colocasia, which is this big leaf with a root. Maybe you do. But they gave me moringa seeds today. Moringa has 196 compared to 35. Are they increasing vitamin A availability in the world or decreasing it? They're decreasing it. More recently, they came up with the idea of we will now make genetically engineered bananas because women in India are dying of iron deficiency anemia in childbirth. One man in Australia, financed by another man in the United States called Bill Gates, they're going to save all the women of India by putting iron into bananas. You have a lot of bananas. The film festival had a film on bananas. When Alexander the Great came to India, it's the first time he saw the banana fruit. And he saw people were eating it. He also realized people were very wise. And he called it the fruit of the wise. So the scientific name of banana is Musa sapientum, the food of the wise. Thousands of varieties in India, 1,500 is what our records tell us. And if today you go to places like Kerala, even in small shops that sell cigarettes and bidis, you will see the tiny little banana, you'll see the red banana, you'll see the cooking banana, you'll see the banana for chips. 200 bananas, varieties are growing in every garden because different bananas are good for different things. And when you take off the skin, it is so thin. And the bananas are delicious. So on my way over here, they served me breakfast on United Airlines. And because I'm a vegetarian, they gave me a banana. And I had to really struggle with a banana to get it to open. The skin was literally half an inch thick. Why has the banana become so much skin and so little taste? Because they've got to ship it. Our food is now moving all the time. It's not being cultivated for eating. It's being bred for processing and shipping. So our delicious tomatoes that used to just melt in the mouth or melt in our pans are now rocks. They're rocks because the tomatoes have to be shipped. And then they have to sit on shelves. And they even tried the first food crop, I'm sure none of you remember this, because the first transgenic food was a tomato called the flavor saver. What is the flavor saver tomato? A tomato that would not rot. Now this was a very rotten tomato, it would just not show that it's rotten. It's a bit like those ladies who don't want to look old, and I love my creases coming as I get older. So they have worked out this silly procedure of putting a poison which paralyzes your face, and your face becomes like that for a while. And it's called Botox. So I would call the flavor saver tomato the Botox tomato. That's totally rotten inside but doesn't show. It was so bad in taste, it never took off. When they introduced it, there was no movement against transgenics in California. But it just went off the shelves because it was so bad. Last night I ordered some fruit for dinner. And usually when I travel and I eat fruit, I have to leave 9/10 of the fruit because it's not edible. You take a knife, normally you take a piece of fruit, you put it in and you eat it. Now you have to use a knife and a fork. And you try and struggle and then half of it goes somewhere else, it flies off. We are not cultivating food, we are not breeding food. We are breeding rocks. Both because rocks can sit and rocks weigh more. Because everything's about weight. It's not about nourishment. So in Navdanya, we started to calculate. How much nourishment is there in the food? How much nutrition per acre are you growing? And I can repeat that kind of study here. Your Milpa system will have nutrition than the corn fields of the United States. In any case, 90% of transgenic corn and soya is not being eaten by humans. It's being going to biofuel and animal feed because the subsidies are bigger in the biofuel sector and the animal feed sector. Food is no more because farmers love to serve the earth. Our peasants, our tribal peasants, when they go to the field, they don't say, I'm going to work. They say, I'm going to beautify the earth. Because in cultivating a seed and planting with care, they are literally putting jewelry on the earth. This is jewelry, isn't it? And when farmers who care for their crop, who care for their seeds, are replaced by farmers who become spraying machines, that's what they are, then the reason they will is according to how much a government will pay them in subsidies. And this is happening in Europe, where half of the money of the taxpayer is going for agribusiness subsidies to sell more pesticides, more seeds, more machinery, and make small farms unviable. That's the case for the United States. So it has to be a stupid system if it can only be kept afloat with $400 billion of subsidies, $1 billion a day. The United States corn that is dumped off Mexico is not cheap to produce. If it was a really level playing field, American corn could not have entered Mexico. But because it has huge subsidies behind it. I did a calculation on soya, because they dumped soya and tried to destroy our edible oil industry, our mustard, our coconut, our amazing, every part of India has a different oil we use for cooking. I noticed the beautiful church in Tapostola, right? It's, the gate is decorated with seeds. And in the seeds are this lovely little seed that most people don't remember anymore, called the Niger seed, which gives some of the purest oil. All of those oil seeds were to be banned because soya oil had to be dumped because it was cheaper. Was it cheaper? $191 subsidy to make the price $150 a ton. You add 150, add 190, nowhere could they grab a market. Without the subsidies, our peasants would not be wiped out. It is an unfair trade which is called free trade. It's free for corporations. It's not free for people. It's clever for how to accumulate the wealth of the world and how to take the seeds that have been in every place of this planet in the hands of billions of farmers. and put it in the hands of 5 companies. That's a clever move, but it's a clever in a nasty way. Not the kind of cleverness that allows humanity to live and thrive and share and create abundance. So I was telling you about the GMO banana. They said they'll give iron in banana. Iron is not banana's virtue. It's very virtuous in every way, but not for iron. It has 0.44 grams in 100 grams, 0.44. They said we will, after 15 years of research and millions of dollars of tax money, we will give you 5 times more iron. So 5 times into 0.44 is 2. Yeah? Looks good. But compare that again to amaranth, which has 11. Neem, the beautiful tree, 25. The Bengal grams leaves, 23. Coconut meal, 69. The Niger seeds I was mentioning that are on that beautiful cake, 56. And you have a lot of mango. We use the dry mango and turn it into a powder to make use as a souring agent. Mango powder, 45. This today at lunch, we had a beautiful tamarind drink which every kid could have. So either this or the tamarind drink, never the Coke and never the Pepsi. Tamarind pulp has 17. No one, no child, no woman needs to have iron deficiency if our biodiversity was allowed to thrive. This hibiscus is one of the richest. One of the richest in iron. The moringa, one little ball of the leaves, is given to girls with low hemoglobin. In one day, they can get to the right balance. Nature has given us so much diversity. Our cultures have evolved so much diversity of knowledge to increase the contributions. But we are made to feel poor. We are made to feel poor by 2 tricks. The first trick is the scientific trick, to turn amazing life like this into a thing. And then say, there's no life in the corn, but when I use a toxic gene and put it into the corn, then I am creating. I call this the illusion of creation. Yeah. You fool yourself into describing violence against the seed as creation. And then you reward yourself with intellectual property rights and patents. Intellectual property rights on seed are a theft. They are a piracy. There is no corn in the world that has not originated here in Mexico. Every patent on corn is a patent on theft. Just like the patents on neem were a patent theft. And I fought for 11 years with the European Greens and IFOAM, the World Movement of Organic Agriculture. 11 years we fought and we have that patent struck down. It was the first time in international law we established that biopiracy is happening. I come from a valley called Dune Valley, which is famous for basmati, the aromatic rice. This aromatic rice was patented by a Texas company. I think they've stolen oil for so long. Where a rice grows, it's still theirs. The company called itself Rice Tech, which is another move. You call anything tech. And then an ancient Indian wheat was patented by Monsanto. Because our wheats have not been bred for industry. Our wheats have been bred for eating. And the more the wheat is bred for factories and mechanical baking, the more gluten it gets, the more elasticity it has to have. So the gluten content goes up. And that's why everyone is having a gluten allergy in today's world. So said, let's patent the Indian wheat, which has no gluten. We fought that case. They had to drop the patent. My government just rejected a Monsanto patent. It's for a climate for all traits of climate resilience in every crop. Every crop. And because we've had a very strong movement, we have in our patent law a clause that says biological processes aren't an invention, that therefore they can't be patented. And Monsanto was trying to own biological processes. The patent office rejected it, the appellate board rejected it. Now they've got the US government threatening us to say, change your laws. That's why I was telling you this morning that we need theater, because it has become so absurd. The stupidity has taken us to such a place of absurdity that unless we start laughing at it, unless we start celebrating our own corn and our own rice and our own seeds and our own knowledge, they're going to threaten us and threaten us and threaten us to say, accept a Monsanto monopoly. But Monsanto's monopoly is not just for seed now. Years ago, someone leaked to me from Monsanto a set of papers. They wanted to control the water. And they would have liked a system where they could buy this stream and then put into the stream the chemicals that were needed for the seeds that they have sold. So if you didn't buy their water and you didn't buy their chemicals and you didn't buy their seed, you wouldn't have a crop. Fortunately, this leak reached me in time, and I started to write about it. I wrote about it in my book, Water Wars, and they had to back off. But just a few months ago, they bought one of the world's biggest corporations monitoring climate data. It's called the Climate Corporation. They bought it up for about $1 billion. So why would Monsanto want climate data? Because they want us all to shut down our public weather services. There's already a bill in the US Congress saying the public weather services that give us broadcasting, that monitor the data, they should shut down. They can still collect the data, because it's very costly to monitor the weather, but it shouldn't be broadcast to the public. Just like the seed is patented, and when something is patented, you can't save a seed. Because the seed means an exclusive right to whatever's patented. And a farmer saving seed is now treated as a thief. I thought this was so wrong when I heard this. I said, we're going to save our seed. And we will never obey laws that make it illegal for us to do our duty for the earth, our duty to the ancestors, because saving seed is saying thank you to them for all their work to give us food. And it's a commitment to the future generations to protect the diversity of seed and the freedom of seed in all its integrity. Today, the peasant women kept referring to the word pure seed. For them, seed that has come over millennia and has evolved is pure. It is not poison. And I think it's so troublesome to try and explain to anyone what is a BT crop. A BT crop is Bacillus thuringiensis. What is Bacillus thuringiensis? It's a soil organism. What does the BT crop have? It has antibiotic resistance markers and it has viral promoters. Why does it have to have? Then you have to go into the technology. You have to go into the gene gun. Isn't it laborious? I've said, in public. In public, we should only talk of GMOs as poison-producing plants, because that's what they do. Earlier, we sprayed poisons from outside, and now these plants are producing in every cell all the time poisons from inside, with no recall. When you find DDT is bad, and in America they used to advertise, DDT is good for me, so they had to ban it. Then they brought all kinds of pesticides in the family called organophosphates, also called the persistent organic pollutants. And these are being banned. Organophosphates are being banned. There's a whole treaty called POPs, Persistent Organic Pollutants, an agriculture that is based on poisons, whether they are poisons of pesticides, herbicides, or poison-producing plants, will harm the earth and it will harm our bodies. In terms of the harm to the earth, we know how so many beneficial species have gone. When we walked down this road, I saw peacocks. In large parts of India, the peacock, which is our national bird, can't be seen anymore. The vultures, which used to recycle dead animals, can't be seen anymore. More recently, the amazing monarch butterfly that comes to Mexico. That 75% monarch butterfly is gone, with a combination of both the BT crops as well as the herbicide-resistant Roundup Ready crop. The BT pollen has toxin, it kills the butterfly. A Cornell study was done where they fed the larvae GMO pollen and non-GMO pollen. And all the larvae that ate the GMO pollen died. The Roundup Ready kills everything green. It's killing the milkweed on which the butterflies nest. And that jointly is pushing the butterflies. 75% of the bees of the world are gone. 75%. And this agriculture, which they say we are producing more food, only 70%, only 30% of what is produced industrially with chemicals goes to human beings. 70% of our food still comes from small farms and gardens. 70%. This is United Nations Food and Agriculture Organization data. Earlier, they used to only calculate what's traded, and they never looked at what's eaten. But rural families grow the food and they eat the food, and it was never counted. But anything that's recycled is never counted. Which brings me to the second trick that is played. The first trick is to call everything dead, and then call your steps of further destruction creation. The second trick is this magnificent number, GDP. Gross domestic product. Gross domestic product only measures what you buy and sell. If you grow, if you produce what you consume, you don't produce. It's the definition of GDP. So nature doesn't produce. These creeks are not producing water. The amazing trees in this valley have not produced themselves. It's when a Coca-Cola will start bottling the water, then water is produced. It's when Monsanto takes a seed and makes it transgenic, there is now production of seed. It's when agribusiness takes over food production, you get production of food. So there's an illusion of the earth as dead, nature as dead, which is called Baconian, Newtonian science. And there's this illusion of GDP, a totally false number that is used to destroy everything we have. Because by not seeing nature's economy and by being blind to people's economy, they can just crash that economy. Every ecological devastation is rooted in this false calculation of what is production. In my view, production is whatever nature gives us, nature produces. In fact, what nature gives us is so big compared to what we can produce. And then we come along and say, the earth, we love you. We say to our biodiversity, we love you. We say to our trees, we love you. And we'll do a little bit of work with you. So we'll do a little bit of water harvesting, we'll do a little bit of seed saving and seed growth. We will put our efforts with the earth and allow the food to grow, but always realizing that we are helpers. We are co-creators, but small players compared to the magnificent creation of the earth. Now, when the combination of the GDP and the false science of a dead earth joins up in the agriculture sector, in the food sector, which is the theme of this year's field. The souls on the earth grow bees to eat 8,500 species of plants across the world. India, Mexico, so much diversity. The first time I had to tell you I ate that cactus. When I was looking in here, I was a bit scared. But when I ate it, it was so delicate. It was delicious. I really feel we need to give literacy classes on biodiversity and nutrition. Those who would improve nutrition by destroying our biodiversity, who would improve food security by destroying the soil and the sea and the water. 75% of the resources of the planet have been destroyed by industrial agriculture. 40% of the greenhouse gases that are making a mess with our climate come from industrial globalized agriculture. The answer, climate change, is resilient soils with organic, lots of diversity, and evolutionary breeding where our crops evolve for the changing climate, decentralization, so you're not dependent on long distance transport, and support systems and solidarity, without which societies could not continue. Now, if 30% of the food comes from a system that is destroying 75% of the planet's renewability and resources, if it's allowed to increase its share from 30% to about 33 to 37%, that destruction will jump from 75 to 100%. That is where humanity's ability to live on this planet ends. That's where we become dead as dodos. Do we want to be dead as dodos as a species? Or will we be more intelligent and recognize the kind of seeds, the kind of food that nourishes us? And besides a predictable genocide of our species, through the destruction of nature's base of the ecological foundation, there is a killing going on through the poisons in our food, through the GMOs. Right now, the Roundup Ready crops are bred for resistance to Roundup, which is glyphosate, a herbicide called glyphosate. 650,000 tons being sold every year. And in the last 2 decades, it has just exploded because everywhere Monsanto is pushing Roundup and glyphosate. In the United States, if you look at the graph of GMO increase, which goes hand in hand with glyphosate increase, it goes hand in hand with all epidemic diseases. 98% correlation. Deaths due to intestinal infections have gone up sixfold. That means 600%. Liver cancers have gone up 200%. Urinary cancer, 210%. The Center for Disease Control just released data that in the last 2 years, autism in children in the United States has jumped from 1 in 88 children to 1 in 68. That's a 30% increase. 30%. Then scientists are showing glyphosate and the GMO is killing our beneficial gut microorganisms. Microorganisms have a lot to do with keeping a balance in our body, particularly with our brain functions. And some studies are showing that if this trend of poisons in the food and GMOs continues, by 2025 in the United States, every second child will be autistic. That's robbing children of their future. 8.2 million people are dying of cancer every year. Diabetes is a new epidemic worldwide. Obesity, 2 billion people around the world because of bad food. 3.5, 4 million annually dead because of diabetes. We are talking about a genocide. Either the farmers of India who commit suicide, or the children who are denied their full growth, or the people dying. And how do these corporations behave when this data comes out? Go after the scientist who has found the connection. They have attacked Arpad Putsai, Sarah Leaney, a scientist called Wakefield showing this autism connection. Any scientist, Ignacio Chapella of Berkeley, any scientist showing environmental harm and health harm is hounded. Because they can buy news, they can buy labs, they can buy universities. They can buy journals. In the case of Seralini, the journal refused to retract his study. They just changed the editor. In the case of Chapella, who showed the contamination of corn in Mexico, it was published in the journal Nature. Suddenly, Nature started to get many emails from scientists. And they panicked and said, okay, we retract the paper. Strange, because you published a paper after peer review. If someone else has a better paper countering that argument, publish another paper. Then let the scientific community publish a third paper. That's how good science is separated from bad science. A journalist in England tracked the science. I want to find out the kind of scientists who are saying this study wasn't reliable. Turns out, this is a new phenomenon, they call it viral marketing. The public relations companies that work for these corporations sit on a computer and cook up names. And then bombard journals. So nowadays, when people say, oh, let's have a digital vote, I said, you can't do a digital vote in this world because the wrong side will vote. So we have to bring democracy back to the ground. We've got to bring democracy where it works with the earth, where it works with people, where it works communities who know each other. That earth democracy is being born everywhere. It's creating a world where grow better food, we have more food, but we have more food by protecting the earth. This false idea that nature is dead and we are separate from nature and we are masters and owners and conquerors is outdated. And the tragedy is an outdated and obsolete worldview, outdated and obsolete science, outdated and obsolete economic model is being pushed on the world through bullying. So I see the corporations, I don't see them as people. They have declared they are persons. The corporation is a person. And in the United States, corporations can steal democracy because they have had two decisions, one in 2010 and one last week, which say that putting any limit to corporations giving money for elections is taking away the freedom of speech of a corporation which is a person. Corporation isn't a person. It's a group of thugs. A gang of greedy men who got together and said, let's rip off society. They used to call themselves the Limited Liability Corporation when the Indian East India Company was formed. Basically, it was privatize the profits and socialize the losses. Something that carries on. But this new phenomena that the corn isn't a person, Eleonora isn't a person, the mango tree doesn't have personhood and subjecthood, the stream doesn't have subjecthood, the only person that exists is the corporation. That is the grand illusion we have to get rid of. Corporations are groups of men, usually men, and they have responsibilities like everyone else. Of course, the few governments they hold in control aren't going to make these changes. We will have to make those changes from the ground up. That's why I talk of Earth democracy as a democracy we shape with the earth. As a democracy we shape by realizing that we work with our corn and we work with our rice. We are powerful. We have strength. We have creativity. And most importantly, we have the collective wisdom of both the earth and our ancestors. How can 5 seed corporations make a bigger difference to this planet? And all the varieties of corn, the 200,000 varieties of rice, the 300 million species on the planet, half of in the world that is women, all of the peasants of the world, the majority of the world wants to live. The project of death is a project that is in the brains of a few people, thinking for a few years they'll make a few profits. But in a planet that's dying and societies that are dying, even those CEOs and shareholders don't have a future. You are so blessed, not just by the corn. You're blessed by your movements. You're blessed by Zapata saying, the land is freedom. Today we have to join Zapata in saying, we will not let down the revolution you started. The seed is freedom, the earth is freedom. Our food is our freedom. Our air is our freedom, our water is our freedom. And that freedom we will defend in any case, because the other option is to die. Gore Vidal wrote in one of his books that the struggle of people against power is the struggle of memory against forgetting. Hold the memory of your corn and your people. Hold the memory of Zapata. Hold the memory of the earth. Hold your own memory. To remember that the illusion of a corporation, the illusion of GDP, the illusion of GMOs, the illusion of intellectual property are just a bunch of illusions manufactured. Those illusions will neither enslave us today nor push us to extinction tomorrow. We will live together with all the species on this planet.
Muchísimas gracias. Vamos a cerrar con broche de oro todavía con 2 invitadas más para aterrizar la realidad local, para entender nuestro contexto. Queremos dar la bienvenida a la doctora María Elena Álvarez Bulloa. La doctora Álvarez Bulloa es una de las investigadoras más sobrevivientes en las ciencias de la vida en México, bióloga y maestra en ciencias por la Facultad de Ciencias de la UNAM, doctora en ciencias por la Universidad de California, Berkeley. Su trabajo ha sido reconocido con 27 distinciones y becas, los premios más destacados en México y Estados Unidos, de los que podemos resaltar el premio a la investigación de la Academia Mexicana de Ciencias, así como la beca Miller, del Instituto Miller para la Investigación Básica en Estados Unidos. Actualmente es investigador del Instituto de Ecología y miembro fundador de la Unión de Científicos Comprometidos con la Sociedad. Bienvenida, muchas gracias. También queremos dar la bienvenida y agradecer su presencia a Adelita San Vicente Tello, ingeniera agrónoma con maestría en desarrollo rural, especializada en economía del sistema agroalimentario, doctorante en agroecología. A lo largo de 10 años se desempeñó en diversos cargos en la administración pública vinculados al sector rural, en diversas instituciones y órdenes de gobierno. Actualmente dirige la Fundación Semillas de Vida, cuya misión es la defensa de la alimentación sana, sin transgénicos, y la protección de las semillas mexicanas, en especial el maíz. En 2007 fue parte de los convocantes de la campaña nacional Sin Maíz No Hay País, que defiende la agricultura campesina y la reactivación en el campo en el cual trabaja hasta ahora. Muchísimas gracias. Bienvenidas. con una profunda gratitud por poder estar aquí. Muchas gracias, Vandana, por este viaje, por todas estas palabras inspiradoras. Muchas gracias a todos ustedes por venir acá esta tarde. ¿Cuántos de ustedes comen maíz todos los días? ¿Cuántos de ustedes quieren seguir comiendo maíz todos los días? Con base en todo lo que nos ha dicho Vandana, creo que tenemos que trabajar desde hoy en día todos y cada uno de nosotros para defender la base de la cultura, de nuestra cultura, de nuestra vida, de nuestro alimento, de lo que nos da identidad. Y no podemos defender este maíz, esta joya de la naturaleza, como nos ha dicho Vandana, si no defendemos la agricultura campesina, los movimientos sociales que emanan de las culturas originarias de este país y de, de la agricultura campesina, que es la base y el sustento de la vida y de la alimentación sana. Entonces, me parece muy importante que además de toda la evidencia científica que yo pudiera compartirles, que es muchísima, y Vandana ha hecho un excelente trabajo en resumir y con una brillantez muy particular el apuntalar los argumentos fundamentales que desde la ciencia, les digo yo, están ya totalmente demostrados. Los transgénicos no producen más, los transgénicos nos están enfermando a la tierra y están cancelando para siempre la soberanía alimentaria. Pero lo que quiero dejar en sus mentes es que no podemos luchar por esta soberanía alimentaria si no luchamos de la mano en contra de la represión, en contra de todos aquellos movimientos que desde los poderes de este capitalismo avasallador están destruyendo para siempre la posibilidad de la soberanía alimentaria. No hay, como dice Vandana, una posibilidad de vida, de soberanía, sin semillas libres, pero tampoco la hay sin comunidades originarias y campesinas libres de represión, como la que está ocurriendo, por ejemplo, hoy en día en este estado de nuestra querida República Mexicana. Entonces, quisiera yo llamar la atención que además de todos los argumentos científicos que puedo yo compartir con ustedes, tenemos que generar una unión, una comunidad de enlazamiento con todas estas luchas que realmente están luchando por mantener esta agricultura y esta posibilidad de alimentos sanos para todos que emanan de las comunidades originarias y de las comunidades campesinas de nuestro país. Con ello, los quiero invitar a que visiten todos los argumentos científicos que no puedo acá repetir, que hemos integrado en un libro que está ahí a disposición de todos ustedes desde la Unión de Científicos Comprometidos con la Sociedad, y de un esfuerzo de integrar estas luchas campesinas, científicas, ciudadanas, de los artistas, de las amas de casa, por recuperar la soberanía, por el cuidado de nuestras vidas, de nuestra salud y por el derecho a decidir qué queremos comer y qué no queremos comer. Y esto lo tenemos que empezar a hacer ya, hoy, de la mano de las comunidades que producen estos alimentos y que hacen que estos alimentos puedan llegar a nuestras mesas, a nuestras casas. Esto es todo lo que yo quiero decirles. Los invito a que acompañen el trabajo que hacemos desde la Unión de Científicos Comprometidos con la Sociedad, pero también a que nos enlacemos con lo que está sucediendo en cada una de las comunidades de los pueblos originarios y campesinos de todo México. Muchas gracias.
Gracias.
Completa violencia por parte de un grupo de...
Saludamos a los jóvenes que en este país nos están enseñando el rumbo. Y los invitamos a que se queden, a los jóvenes, para cerrar esta magnífica conferencia que nos ha brindado Vandana Shiva y que gracias a Cinema Planet hoy la tenemos entre nosotros. Creo que esta conferencia, larga charla que nos brindó Vandana, nos habla de lo que el peligro que tenemos enfrente de México. Nos hermana con un país como la India, un país tan megadiverso como el nuestro, un país que ya ha sufrido la embestida de Monsanto, la embestida con el algodón, la embestida con la berenjena. Nosotros aquí en México somos un país hermano, somos un país pleno de biodiversidad. 16% de lo que hoy come la humanidad se lo brindó esta tierra, México, Mesoamérica, al mundo entero. Y como lo decía Vandana, lo brindó de manera gratuita. No cobró por ello ni queremos cobrar. Lo que sí no queremos es que se lo apropien las empresas. Esa riqueza existe gracias a las campesinas y los campesinos de este país. Que el gobierno de Salinas de Gortari y ahora el gobierno de Peña Nieto está empeñado en acabar con ellos. Nosotros estamos convencidos de que si queremos una alimentación sana, esta agricultura campesina debe ser reforzada, debe ser apoyada y debe de pararse este genocidio de campesinos que bien nos narró Vandana. Los campesinos mexicanos han sido destinados a migrar hacia Estados Unidos. 6 millones desde que firmamos el Tratado de Libre Comercio han tenido que migrar. Tenemos hoy más hambre que cuando se firmó el Tratado de Libre Comercio. Somos el país con más obesos del mundo y eso es gracias a este modelo que nos ha impuesto un gobierno. Un gobierno que hoy se empeña en una reforma para el campo, que va, uno de los centros de su reforma para el campo es introducir el maíz transgénico. Pero desde la tierra del maíz estamos seguros y lo debemos hoy frente a Vandana recalcar y recalcar todos en la tierra de Morelos. El maíz transgénico no va a entrar a México. No vamos a permitir todos y todas los mexicanos que entre el maíz transgénico. Eso lo vamos a impedir. Lo vamos a impedir como podamos. Hoy les quiero platicar que tenemos una demanda, una acción colectiva en que hemos logrado que se suspendan las siembras de maíz transgénico. También con una demanda tenemos suspendida por parte de los apicultores la siembra de soya transgénica. Pero esto no es definitivo. Tenemos todos que defender estos baluartes que tenemos en México, nuestro maíz, nuestra apicultura, que todavía somos un país que produce miel y que la están terminando. Toda esa pequeña apicultura que existe en nuestro país le darían al traste con la soya transgénica. Así que desde donde estemos tenemos que luchar. No nos podemos ir de aquí nada más pensando vinimos a la Vandana y qué felices estamos. Estamos tocados ya por esta palabras de Vandana y por este compromiso que tenemos por defender a nuestra agricultura. Ese compromiso se refleja primero que nada en esto que consumimos día a día. Día a día tenemos que estar claros que lo que consumimos puede beneficiar ¿a quién? A nuestros campesinos o a las grandes empresas transnacionales. Tenemos una gran comida mexicana, una gran comida mexicana que se refleja en nuestra alegría, en nuestras aguas de limón con chía, en nuestros maíces. Pensemos lo que comemos todos los días y ese es el primer acto político que podemos hacer. Enseguida difundamos, que todo mundo sepa lo que hay atrás de los transgénicos. Nosotras estamos convencidas de que si todos supiéramos lo que encierran los transgénicos, lo que hoy nos platicó Vandana, todos saldríamos a la calle a defender ese maíz del que estamos hechos. Y en tercer lugar, sumémonos, sumémonos. Nosotros ahorita tenemos una campaña muy importante para cazar transgénicos. Sabemos que los transgénicos están en muchos alimentos industrializados, están en nuestro campo, los gobiernos están repartiendo semillas y no sabemos realmente qué semillas. Entonces, desde el campo, cuidemos nuestras semillas. Nuestras semillas, como ya se dijo, es el mejor baluarte que tenemos, es nuestra herencia. Cuidemos esa gran herencia, cuidemos el modo de ser campesino. El modo de ser campesino está en riesgo si no lo defienden los gobiernos, si realmente los gobiernos no se comprometen con ese modo campesino de producir alimentos. Está en nuestras manos exigirle al gobierno que son esos los alimentos que queremos comer. No queremos comer McDonald's, ni Burger King, ni sopa sin ramen, ni Bimbo, ni cornflakes. Queremos nuestros frijoles, queremos nuestro maíz, porque estamos convencidos que sin maíz no hay país y sin frijol tampoco, y que en esa agricultura campesina tenemos la alimentación que necesitamos los mexicanos. Entonces, pues los invitamos a consumir alimentos frescos, campesinos, a dejar de lado las grandes tiendas y a comprometerse con esta lucha en la defensa de la agricultura campesina y de nuestra planta sagrada que es el maíz. Gracias.
Muchísimas gracias, muy buenas noches. Esta ha sido una tarde excelsa, un atardecer bellísimo. Estamos muy felices de concluir este Festival de Cine y Medio Ambiente. Queremos agradecer a Adelita San Vicente su participación y su apoyo enorme en la organización del Carnaval de las Semillas, que ha concluido con 2 días de diálogo, de intercambio, de conexiones, de arte. Y de, bueno, pues personalidades muy importantes y muy ricas. A todas las organizaciones que nos apoyaron para este festival, para este Carnaval de Semillas, por supuesto al parque, a su director Fernando Serrano, y a la Secretaría de Sustentabilidad, Topiltzin Contreras, y por supuesto a la Secretaría de Cultura también. Voy a pasarle la palabra a Eleonora para cerrar y agradezco muchísimo su presencia. Les deseamos una semilla muy fértil de aquí en adelante.
Bueno, a mí me corresponde entregar este presente reconocimiento a María Elena Álvarez Guyán por esta participación. Felicidades.
Y bueno, Bandana, muchísimas gracias por haber venido. Nuevamente te agradezco muchísimo el gesto de haber venido desde India a Cuernavaca. Y bueno, aquí está nuestro trofeo del festival con todo nuestro... Es el cangrejito barranqueño, que es una especie de Cuernavaca que está en peligro de extinción. Este es el trofeo del festival y con él pues se va todos nuestros aplausos y todo nuestro cariño y nuestra promesa de lucha. Muchas gracias a todos y chicos, nos vemos en el 2015. Muchas gracias y seguimos en lucha. Hasta pronto.
Por favor, tengan mucho cuidado al salir, abran todos sus sentidos. Este parque les guiará el río. Y bueno, acompañémonos. Por favor, devuelvan sus audífonos. Muchísimas gracias a la traductora y al equipo de traducción y bueno, pues apoyémonos, sigamos juntos haciendo un mundo mejor. Gracias.